my friend Ted and this extraordinary gathering here. I wish I could make your hour a little more bearable, but since it's raining outside, I believe that you have no other option but to be here for a while. In other words, this is a very queer, very strange subject to be speaking on, because you've heard all this while that leadership is very contextual. Leadership belongs to time and space. You need to know the organizational landscape in order to decide what kind of leadership you require. There is nothing called a good leader or a bad leader. There is only a good fit leader or a bad fit leader. All this is okay. But I'm just sensing that, you know, there has been too much of a discourse. The narrative is slightly skewed towards what is so obvious. And this afternoon, for lack of a better word, I want to put to sleep some of those assumptions that you've made and some great theories that evolved out of Harvard, MIT, Wharton. I've come to realize that just as marketing does not belong to Philip Kotler, leadership does not belong to John Carter or Jack Welch. They are great exponents. They're great, you know, crusaders for ideas. But here is an idea that lived a few thousand years before, you know, John Carter developed his own theory of leadership. Much before Christ was born, here was a book called the Gita, and I thought I should position that work because it is not my work. I'm just one of those, you know, people who is trying to understand the wisdom that's inherent in it. So if there is a problem in your comprehension, it is because of my inadequacy. It is not the greatness of the work that I'm calling into play. So please forgive me for not being an extraordinary exponent of that great work. There have been many people. Somebody from IVU has to take care of that. I don't want that to surface on my... So could anyone help out a little bit? How to? Yeah, thank you so much. My fellow citizen is in the IT business. And so all I'm saying is it possible? Thank you so much. You might be called into play again. So all I'm saying is it possible? Is it possible for us to recognize that here are some ideas, a set of ideas that can be transcreated, not translated, transcreated, transported from the distant past and to be contextualized in the present moment? In short, can we be timely and timeless at the same time? If we can't be, then this work has no relevance. Okay? Now, you might think, so how does one miss out the whole issue of the context in the journey of the timeless? Just look at, for instance, my own experience. You know, I had a very different upbringing. Whereas in London, you drive on the left. In Calcutta, where I grew up, you drive on whatever is left. Okay? And so... And so my own mind, my brain absorbs, you know, the chaos of the world far better than your mind would probably. So if you think that why does this guy go back 2,500 years and then he comes back again, well, that's the way we have been. So I don't see this as an extraordinary capability. Don't give me any credit for that. It's just my upbringing. You see, the shoes were crafted in China. My whole jacket got stitched in Lucknow, India. My glasses come from Chennai. My software called my brain is an accumulated gift of my teachers, my parents. And if I take away my voice, is because my parents gave me birth. And if I take away all the contributory values of what made me, then I'm reduced to nothing and I don't have the voice to say it. So I'll say, okay, so just look at the whole journey of the timeless. Look at those tulips in Holland. They're aligned, very linear. Look at a Japanese garden. It's apparently very chaotic, but they are also aligned in some way. Now look at the underlying principle behind the two. There is symmetry, there is harmony, there is beauty. And if you say, well, I would run management or leadership like the tulips in Holland, then you will do disservice to a Japanese garden. Okay, if you say, I'm going to only be like the Japanese, then you'll do disservice to the tulips. So not to discredit the linear or the non-linear, but there is something underneath that, something very timeless beyond temporal values that you attribute. And I think this morning, this afternoon, this extraordinary set of minds in Oxford will spares. There should be some willing suspension of disbelief. How can 2,500-year, 100-year-old text be relevant? So I move on to a little deconstruction of what this seminar is all about. And then I'm saying, look at the word timeless. And it simply means that it is time invariant. Time invariant. And leadership means, why would someone answer the question, why would someone follow you? Because I assume that if there's no follower, there's no leader. But if you add the two expressions, timeless leadership, it simply means, why would somebody follow you beyond the limits of power, position, and privilege that makes them follow you? Because there's something out there. There's a carrot there or a stick. Okay, carrot is often the stick, people don't realize. There's a carrot or a stick. So what is that will enable you to follow somebody beyond the temporal considerations of money, power, and privilege? And that's the question I've been asking for the last 20 years. And if you say, well, have you found the answer? I said, no, I haven't really found the answer, but I could this afternoon with you. So all I'm saying is it possible to combine these two and ask that question, that counter question, very counterintuitive question? Can there be leadership that transcends contexts, that's timeless, that's spaceless? And you might wonder, what is this timeless thing? You know, each of us sitting here wants infinite knowledge. You're curious to know beyond your context. Like, you're infinitely in quest for knowledge. You want unlimited happiness. You want existence that is sort of never ceases, even after your death. There's a post-mortem world out there that you speculate about. All this will give you symptomatic evidence of the fact that we are, in some way, interested in the timeless. Otherwise, we wouldn't ask those questions. We wouldn't be curious infinitely. We wouldn't seek infinite knowledge or power or happiness. So what is that? How do you then reconcile this with whatever is happening in the space of leadership? And I'm going to look at three elements of timeless leadership that I think are what one has gleaned out. So what's happening in that battlefield before I go to the three elements? Here is somebody whose name is Krishna, and there is another guy whose name is Arjuna, and what they're doing is they are having a conversation in the middle of war in a battlefield. Arjuna's problem is he's a heroic person of heroic proportions, but he has a performance breakdown in the middle of battle. He can't lift his bow and arrow because he has some emotional issues with going to battle. And there his mentor Arjuna and Krishna is telling him, well, look here, let's go a little deeper than the goal in hand. It's not about the goal of the battle, it's about a larger purpose, and you see how your goal fits into that. So we go into the whole conversations between Arjuna and Krishna, and we actually make it contemporary, and we say, well, here is a leader who's having a performance breakdown in the middle of excruciating, environment where there's an information, sort of cascading information. He can't handle that anymore. Balancing information set, so his eyes cannot live on the screen for more than 10 seconds. He is not able to process so much data. He's not able to balance the paradoxes in his life, quality, value, quarterly reports and sustainability of the organization. And he can't hold on to that tension anymore, so he looks for a counsel. And here is a counsel right in the middle of the battle. And he's saying, well, look at these three issues. And I'm gleaning out three secrets from the Gita, and I'm presenting this to you. And the three secrets are purpose, performance, and possibility. If you just look at these three and then come to your own conclusions about what they are, it'll be great. So if I look at the word purpose, I have a question to ask. And the question is, how is purpose different from a goal? And very often people confuse this. They think purpose is some kind of an abstraction. It is some kind of a philosophical speculation about life and work. Much less than that. People think purpose is sort of, irrelevant, because I don't think I have time to think of that. But the point is that purpose is nothing but integration of goals. Now, I'll give you an example that you will probably never forget in your lifetime. You have a heart. I'm presuming everybody has a heart and you know that, okay? And the heart beats roughly 72 times a minute, 72 times a minute, and it is almost like your fist beating. And if you look at the American Heart Association figure, then you'll know that if you've lived to the age of 68, your heart would have, beaten about 2.6 billion times without a break. Now, if I want you to simulate the beating of the heart with your fist like this, more than 72 times a minute average, and ask you to do everybody the same thing for roughly half an hour, you'll take me to court, right? You will not be able to do that because you can't sustain it. And you may say, well, because it's not possible because the fist is not designed to do it. Heart is. Now, that's a clever argument, but that's not a wise argument. Functionality follows the purpose, not the other way around. So why can't you do it at the fist, which you can do with the heart? Because the heart does not have a specific goal. It has a purpose. The fist has a goal given to it by the outsider, saying that you have to do it as many times. I'll give you a compensation if you fall ill. Okay? And the fist has a goal, but the heart has a goal as well as a purpose. But more importantly, it has a purpose. Its goal is integrated with the goals of the rest of the body. So if you're meditating, your heartbeat will come down from 72 times a minute to much less. If you're jogging or running, it will go up. And so it is calibrating, it is navigating the pursuit of its personal goal with the goals of the others. So it is an integration of goals. And that's what organizations are all about. Now, if you say, I have the pursuit of a goal, I am the CEO, I'm going to have exponential increase in my salary, and at the same time, I'll retrench people, that certainly is not work on purpose. And we're seeing the fallout of that. Okay? So just take the example of a person whose name is Lord Hunt. He was from this country. He was the third in line to conquer Mount Everest, first few human beings that went to Everest. Not many people have heard the name of Hunt. They have heard of Tenzing Norgay and Edmund Hillary. They were the first ones to go on Everest. Hunt was third in line, and they had got news that Edmund Hillary and Tenzing Norgay had already conquered Everest, and they were just about a couple of kilometers away from that pursuit, reaching the peak. They could have been the third human beings to have gone there. Lord Hunt turned back, and he started to climb down. And when he came down, the press guys asked him, why did you actually come down? You could have been the third. That would have been quite an achievement, third human being. He said, no, when we started the climb, we got together, all the climbers, mountaineers, and we decided that somebody has to be conquering Everest on this trip, not who. Someone among us, not who. And when that purpose was fulfilled, I saw no reason for me to go there again, just to embellish the gold. Just look at the enormity of that, the power that comes from that in an organizational context. A team, a football team in championship form. It doesn't matter who scores the goal, but the goal is scored. Real Madrid, with all the stars, that year couldn't win a single major championship. Why? They're all the stars, but the stars together didn't have a purpose. So just think of this. You know, these great schools like Oxford, Harvard, MIT, I think you're fed on a diet of pursuit of goals, and we become goal sick. So if you thought this was just an example from the world of, you know, mountaineering and sports, I'll bring you to a corporate world. And I'll ask you to revisit the life of J.R.D. Tata. 50 years back in Jamshedpur, he goes to a plant, and where his employees are shouting slogans, they will strike work. And his HR manager is by him, and J.R.D. looks at the striking people in the heat of Jamshedpur, 40 above, you know, 40 plus Celsius. Degrees Celsius, and he looks at them and he asks his HR head, why are they shouting? He says, you know, they are disgruntled most of the time. We have fulfilled most of the demands. They have no reason to shout, but since you are in campus, you're in town, they find that this is a good opportunity for them to air their views, so they're shouting. So, sir, please ignore them. Let's move on. Jerry says, okay, see, don't worry. I mean, about the shouting, that's not what bothers me. What bothers me is they're shouting under the hot sun. And they don't have water to drink. So can you provide them a shade under which they can shout and provide them with a glass of lime water? Okay, for the next 50 years, there are no strikes, okay, in that plant. Now, what is J.R.D. trying to do here? A CEO who was not an engineer, but he recruited some of the best engineers of the country. That's how the entire Tata, you know, empire grew from there. So what he's trying to do is essentially saying that, well, my purpose is profitability of the enterprise, but this guy's purpose is a little shade. His goal is a little shade. His goal is a little, you know, sense of security that he belongs to some organization that cares. And if these two are not integrated, there cannot be organizational, there cannot be institutions. So, you know, there is a difference between building a business and building an organization or an institution. Building a business is an aggregation of resources. You can be clever and build a business, make it a $1 billion company. But building an organization means that you have to sustain a purposive work. Otherwise, organizations, you know, think of Anderson, think of Enron, think of Satyam in India, think of any organization that fell by the wayside, you will see the same story over and over and over again. Purpose has been replaced by narrow goals. And this is where we come to a very timeless, you know, understanding of the fact that purpose is not against goals. Please don't get that idea from here. Purpose is essentially the way to fulfill your goals in a more sustainable way, perhaps faster. You know, somebody like Ratan Tata used to say on behalf of the Tatas, if you have to go fast, go alone. But if you have to go far, you must go together. If you go far, you must go together. And that's what purpose is. Is that clear? So this is what Arjuna is hearing from Krishna. He said, your goal is not to fight this battle. Your purpose is dharma. Somebody has violated rule of law. And your job is to fight for restoration of rule of law. Rule of the ruler is not the rule of law. Rule of the ruler is dogma. Rule of law is dharma. And when dogma runs over dharma, there is a real trouble. And this is what Arjuna is called to play. You know, he says, well, I have to protect the rule of law because the rule of the ruler violates. If you're a whistleblower within the company, you're taking on the rule of the ruler, you have consequences. That's why you don't take on. But if you don't take it on, you're not fulfilling a purpose for which you were born. This is very critical. I think the brightest here will have to respond to that demand that, you know, am I fulfilling my dharma as a corporate warrior? No, this is the Indian art of war, unlike the Chinese art of war. You know, we are complementary, we have a complementary. Chinese art of war is about craft, about design, about being smart, which is very essential. However, the Indian art of war is very different. Indian art of war is, you are not a fighter, you are a warrior. Fighter fights with the other, warrior fights with himself or herself. And in a corporate war, the fundamental fight is with yourself. Okay, that fight is about purpose versus goals. The second order reality is performance. And I want to show you a picture of performance breakdown. You know, this is what is called a silo mentality. The guy from the forest department says, it's not my job. It's not my job. I would rather distort the whole organization than do somebody else's job. Not my job. So what you see as performance is fundamentally that. You know, potential limited by organizational silos, by structures. Now, how do I survive? So if I look at performance as the art of undoing, which is very counterintuitive, we have always thought that our performance means more. But I'm saying, no, it is less of the more. Why is it less? Because you saw that small I, P is, capital P is your potential in the performance space. Small P is your actual performance. Why small P is so much less than capital P? Because there are constant interference patterns. You know, there's something going on in your head all the time. Base, you know, this is what is called silo-based thinking, sensory thinking. Now, I'll give you an example. You might laugh at it, but that example is very powerful. George Bush and Dr. Manmohan Singh are in a quiz competition, heads of states. You know, both of them are gone, so I have no problem. I'll not be jailed anymore. So all I'm saying is it possible to contemplate there is in a quiz competition and the quiz master is asking a question. Suppose a child is born to your mother, neither your daughter nor your son. What is your relationship, not your sister, neither your brother nor your sister. What is your relationship to the child? I'll repeat that question again. Suppose a child is born to your mother, neither your brother nor your sister. What is your relationship to the child? Dr. Manmohan Singh is good with these things. So he says, sir, that's me. And George Bush is still in doubt. So he loses the prize and he goes back to United States of America and he says to his Secretary of State, Madam Rice, I'm really anxious to know the answer to the question. Suppose a child is born to your mother, neither your brother nor your sister, what is your relationship with the child? Madam Rice has said, this is a very complex question. I must go and ask this defense secretary, Colin Powell, who is very intelligent, and he might be able to figure out. So she goes to Colin and said, Colin, suppose a child is born to your mother, neither your brother nor your sister, blah, 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 what would be your relationship with the child? And Colin says, oh, that's me, Madam Rice. Madam Rice goes back to George Bush and says, sir, finally I have found the answer. The answer is Colin Powell. And Colin Powell, is that what you thought the answer was? George Bush is absolutely livid. And he says, come on, I gave you so much time. You're the Secretary of State. You come back after a lot of speculation with the wrong answer. Didn't you know the right answer is Dr. Manmohan Singh? See what has happened here. You have laughed, but you know, just see what has happened here. Great leaders get caught in correlations. They don't see causality. The reason they don't see causality is because they see performance as a correlation between effort and reward. But you know, very often there's a non-linear relationship between effort and reward. You may make great effort, you may not get the best grades. You may miss a McKinsey job or a BCG job. See, the reward, the equation of reward is not entirely in your hands. So when you're looking in the world of performance, all that you must think of doing, not must, you should, and you will, if you understood this, is just minimize interference to your potential. The maximum interference comes from a thing called ego. You know, I am this, I am that. You know, I'm the vice president of the Can Openers Association. That also gives you an ego. That's fine, healthy thing to do. But if you cannot go underneath this talk constantly limiting your potential, because these are interference. Interferences can come from company cultures. It can come from countries' cultures. But the primary interference is how you have sort of your mental models that are dysfunctional, that does not work in the performance space. And this is something that I want you to be. I often do an exercise in the corporate context is, who are you without your business card? And very often people falter. I'm nothing without my business card. See how your identity gets co-opted by a job description, which is just a role description, which is not your description of who you are. And that is what you have to be wary about. So this interference pattern is very critical. Okay, I'm going to go into the last aspect and then we'll take a little break and we'll do something new. Okay, we're looking at possibility, the third P. And the moment I say possibility, you probably have to look at possibility as something in the future. That's what you think, future. Possibility connotes the word that it is not real now, it might be real in the future, but there's a possibility. In short, the functional aspect of looking at possibility is, how do I enhance the horizon of my perception? How do I enhance the horizon of my perception? And it is not always easy to do so unless you go through a certain orientation, unless your mind goes through a certain orientation to a reflective consciousness. You know, I had often been, rather than a reactive mind is something that is constantly in the sort of, you know, in the monkey mode. You know, it is constantly doing, you know, instinctively reacting to stimulus. But a reflective consciousness is something that can actually absorb the stimulus that the reactive mind receives and yet maneuver the stimulus, you know, hold back. A great poet of England, John Keats, used an expression long back in the 17th century called negative capability. Those of you who have studied literature will know that what he was talking about is what the great rishis of India were saying. Negative capability doesn't mean that you are incapable. It doesn't mean that you're negative. It simply means the ability to withhold your need to act immediately. And therefore, you come up with better ways of acting. The ability to process uncertainty. You know, you live in uncertainty. Most of us don't know how to live in uncertainty. We immediately would be reactive through our emotional states. Now, if you know how to live in uncertainty, that uncertainty will give you clues as to go forward. And corporate world is an uncertain world. Now, what would that be? I'll just give you a couple of examples that will sit with you very clearly. Look at a Gandhi traveling by a train. As the train begins to move, one of his shoes falls down on the railway track. And the train has begun to move. So he looks wistfully at that shoe. And if I was Gandhi, if somebody, if I were that, and some of you were in that place, you recognize that at the emotional level, you'll feel a sense of loss. You're uncertain what to do. One shoe has gone, you've just won. And you will either, if you are pulling back based on your past experiences, you'll either try to hold the train back or you'll tell somebody, yeah, this has happened, and you might feel emotionally upset. But he did none of that. You know what he did in a few split seconds is he took the other of the pair and threw it on the track. And somebody standing next to him said, what the hell did you do? He said, you know, now the person who actually finds a pair will have a pair to wear. A poor man has a pair to wear. One is of no value to me, one is of no value to him. Look at the consciousness that creates a greater decision space given the constraints of the situation. Are you there? I'm going to conclude this world of possibility with two things. One, an example from a corporate world, somebody who's made a lot of money for you and for himself. And a little composition that I have done with a great musical talent of India called Pandit Vishwamohan Bhatt. He's a guru who's gotten the Grammy Award for one of his compositions. So he and I composed something on silence, and I'm going to play that. It's okay. So wait for the best to come. The best hasn't come yet. So the story is about a person who created a product called the Visa. All of you who has a bank card will have Visa on it. But do you know who created it? Many of you would not know. His name is D. Hawk. And at the Kennedy School of Government, I had a conversation opportunity with him, and this lasted 10 minutes on the phone. And my first question to him was, Mr. Hawk, what is your opinion about the personal banking industry of today? He said, I don't care. And then I said, what? How would you like to be remembered as a good grandfather? What is your current occupation? I'm a farmer in California. I said, you also sit on the board of Visa as CEO Emeritus of Visa. You're on the board of Harvard Business Review, so I have a right to ask you, what did you do when you thought of Visa as an idea? He said, I redefined money. I said, you redefined money? How come? He said, I defined money as human energy impulse that can be alphanumerically coded on a plastic card, and those impulses could be transmitted across the continents, across the seas, provided you had two things behind the transmission process. One is value, the other is trust. Any institution that has these two is potentially a bank. That was his operating definition of money. I said, my God, how would you convert that knowledge into, how do you execute? So the idea is not just that knowledge, but Visa as an idea is great, but how do you execute? He said, I had a simple solution. I said, why don't I create a card like a business card that a farmer in California or a grocer in India can punch in? And if there is money there, he can be a Rockefeller or an ordinary feller. But the money is going to come out if there is value and trust. So I made execution that simple and user-friendly. So here is this wealth of knowledge. Here is this simplicity of execution and the connect between the two. Then my next question was, then how do you go around and convince several other banks so that Visa gets acceptable to the banking fraternity? Who would buy that idea in the conventional banking, where banking was equivalent to collaterals, large buildings? Okay, who would buy that simple idea that it was value and trust amplified first, you know, condensed in alphanumerically on a plastic card and then amplified across continents? Who would buy that idea? He said, I had a mantra. I said, that's an Indian word. What was your mantra? What does the word mantra mean to you? He said, anything that works is mantra. I said, tell me what was the mantra. He said, each time I met a person who was superior to me in rank, hierarchy, or talent, my mantra for him or her would be, I'm as great to myself as you are to yourself, therefore we are equal. And he said, there was another part of the mantra. The other part was, any time I saw somebody inferior to me in rank, hierarchy, or talent, my mantra for him or her would be, you are as great to yourself as I am to myself, therefore we are equal. I said, did that always work? He said, no, but it never failed to help. Why did it help? It helped because each time I spoke to somebody, it was spoken on the authenticity of the content of what I was saying, not based on whether I was afraid of a superior or condescending, you know, of somebody who was inferior. So communication worked. If it is based on authenticity, it does work. It has a tendency to work. So it worked. I said, that's massive wisdom. I said, you know, since we are on the phone and we have reached the last end, I want to tell you about the Indian Namaste. He said, that's your national greeting. I said, this is slightly more than a greeting, if you permit me. He said, yes, of course, tell me what it is. So I said, you have to fold your hands together, your palms touching each other, fingers pointing upwards, and the two thumbs pointing towards the heart, and your head is lowered slightly towards the gesture. And in that gesture, can you do this, sir? I asked him. I'm not asking you to do it, so I've asked him. So yes, I have done it. I said, then you look at the person in front of you, in this case me, you are on the phone, and say the same divine that lives in you and me. And before you do that, just remind yourself of the gesture. He said, all the power in my head, power of cognition, with all the power in my hands, power of execution, and all the power of the heart, the power of affection, connect with people. I recognize, I acknowledge the divine that resides in you and me in equal measure. There was silence at the other end of the phone. So I said, if you're an atheist, if you don't believe in the divine, replace the word divine with Visa power, the formula remains the same. He says, how come? I said, you know, when the thinking system of the organization, the planning system, the cognitive complexity of organizational life, when it connects with simplicity of execution And when it connects with the heart of people who are into the framework of execution, and if you respect the person as though it was just an expression of you, a different expression of you, forget the word divine for the time being, then organizations become great because people become great. People live their potential. Okay? People begin to live their potential. That's a formula that has always worked. This is timeless. Okay? So how do I get to the world of the timeless? This is the next question. And I'll leave you about 15 minutes for question and answers. So you can go at me, have a real go at me. No problem. Okay, just see, how do you access the source of possibilities? This is something interesting. You have a thought trigger, you have an emotion, and you have impulse to action. But you can see, you can break the impulse to action by intervention of an observer, which means that observer needs to be attended to. This observer resides in everybody, and it's a timeless thing. You know, if you ask me, what is in the room that is timeless? Nothing is. All the chairs, tables are subject to decay in time, including your body. Okay. People say in Harvard and Oxford, there's a life of the mind, but the life is also short-lived. You know, but there's an observer that can come to a conclusion that it is short-lived. And that observer is an impersonal identity. It can see the futility of holding on to temporal values. It can see only the human being. A zebra cannot see that. Only the human constitution has the gift of seeing the timeless in the tapestry of time. And so if you have to break this, go to the source observer, sometimes 1/4 of a second, for lack of a better word, I would call this observer silence, because that is the identity of the observer. There are three values that you can attribute to the observer: ability to listen without prejudgment, ability to observe without your words coming up in your head. Yeah? Do you see this? Ability to see things beyond the obvious. These are all values that one associates with the observer. Okay? Because I don't want to spend too much time on silence, talking about it certainly. So I'll play that music, piece of music. Give me a little time. Mother of a deaf girl with muted sorrow in her eyes said, "Tell us about silence." Ananda waited for the murmur of the eucalyptus leaves to whisper its last secrets through the hills. He seemed absorbed in a wordless conversation with himself. As he said, thank you. Silence is the womb of all that is spoken and heard. Silence is the river, the flow of the river of intelligence. Like river banks, words are mere interruptions of this flow. Silence is the unspoken truth of the universe. Words are at best masks that embellish the face of truth with their many devices. The forlorn lover sitting on the edge of the river pines for a lost love in dumb despair. Only numbing silence, only numbing silence, only numbing silence. Connects heart with heart. Silence, words return to their essence just as noisy rivers merge with the ocean. Through words, one becomes many. In silence, many return to the one. In silence, creation happens. The master in us has created a house called the universe. Through words, we knock at the door of this house. In silence, the chest of treasure is flung open. Speak, but do not stand in the way of the music of silence. Your words are useless without the music. The original voice of life is silence. All other noises of the world. Are mere echoes.